there's a perfect storm in terms of demand for housing in London. In Ealing, you have to be earning £90,000 to be able to buy, so it's pretty prohibitive for most people. Prices in the private rented sector are going up. Landlords feel that they can get more rent from people who are not on benefits, and so people are being impacted by welfare reform and benefit caps. So our numbers of families that are wanting emergency accommodation are going up, and they have been doing for the last couple of years now. It's a real problem for us, and we're having to think of all kinds of solutions. We look to put people in some of our decanted regeneration housing estates before we knock them down and rebuild them. But the crisis is so big that we're having to look at every solution.
Shipping container architecture is increasingly becoming more popular, more increasingly adopted in a range of applications, a lot of entertainment, retail, restaurants. You know, it's quite funky, it's different. I think architects and designers like them because you've got that structural integrity. You know, you can cantilever them off each other, you can play with them, you can literally take the container and invert it and stand it on its end, and it performs really well structurally and things like that. So, you know, there's a lot of inherent strength in the product. They're relatively accessible in terms of their cost as a brick, and they're not moving on from the UK. So being able to take the stock and turn it into something different, you know, the sort of upcycling mentality, that's really interesting. The housing projects that we're involved in with the London Borough of Ealing are really around bringing brownfield sites back into use. And we're using a movable building product to provide what we call a meanwhile use. The end users are going to be people coming out of bed and breakfast, going to be used for temporary accommodation within the borough, which is one of the really big issues that Ealing are facing at the moment.
Hanwell Place is the second site that we've used to put these container homes for people who are in emergency housing need. We've got increasing difficulty finding bed and breakfast places for them. We're having to go further afield outside of the borough, and this gives us a solution that's in borough, which often works for the people that we're looking to house because they've already got their connections with the local area, with schools, and so if we're not sending them further away, it's much better for them. It's actually cheaper for the council as well, because bed and breakfast costs are rising and it's a significant draw on our budgets, and we're being squeezed financially as the government cuts our grant. So this is a good solution, we think.
Early on in this project, we undertook a lot of research working with Brighton Housing Trust and talking to their clients around, okay, what are some of the really important things? Own front door was the big one. Own front door, own kitchen, own bathroom. So the initial provision is very simple, everything you'd expect in a home. Continuing on that development process and working with Ealing, one of the big problems that Ealing encountered is void periods. So being able to sort of essentially refurbish a home after somebody has moved on from it, a lot of work with them around ensuring that the walls are easily cleanable, that all of the appliances are easily replaceable should anything go wrong, that the kitchens are robust, you know, they're not made out of chipboard, you know, they're metal carcasses that are going to withstand use. Then in terms of where we're sat at the moment and the project that's going to Hope Gardens in Ealing, we've got a range of studios, one bedrooms and two bedrooms, so it's your standard affair in terms of an apartment.
Storage on site is a company which is set up really to use modular units, so your containers where we can use the 20-foot and 40-foot main base frame to make into site storage units, offices, canteens, anything that you want. It was going to a 20-foot by 8-foot box. The manufacturing base was originally America through the aluminium containers, then went to Europe and the UK, and over the last maybe 15 to 20 years, most of production now is on production lines mainly out of steel in China.
We put an order in with a Chinese factory. All the containers nowadays are produced in China. We give them the fleet numbers that the containers are meant to have. They then build them to our specification. They send them over with a cargo inside. And then when they arrive in the UK, the cargo gets taken out, and then they arrive into our depot here in Southampton. A lot of the containers will get reused for shipping, so they'll either go back with an export back to the Far East or the Middle East, wherever it's got to go to. A percentage of them will stay in the UK for companies like ourselves, or some of them are bought on spec to be modified and changed into whatever needs to be done. But the high percentage will be continuously used for shipping for a number of years. We know of companies that built over 1 million containers last year just themselves, so you're talking at least 2 million containers, maybe 3 per year. It's hard to give a number because no one truly knows. There's a lot of different manufacturers out there, but it's in the millions.
In terms of the units that we're using, the majority of them have done some work at sea. Most of the companies that are converting containers are using single-use containers, which are, they might have been used once. We take the containers from, generally from Southampton or Felixstowe docks, and take the stockpiles into the factories here in the UK, and converting them using fairly traditional construction methodology, but we're looking at sub-assembly and components. So the walls are panels. We're not necessarily using traditional plasterboard, stud walling, and the these types of products. We're very much looking around quick assembly, designed for deconstruction, reuse. We have about sort of 4 products that you're looking at the moment. It's modular in the nature of how the products join together. So if you want to create a 2-bedroom product, you take a bedroom, and the kitchen unit, and you join them together. If you wanted to make a bigger one, you could literally slide another one in the middle with the corridor and the other bedroom in it. Added onto that, again, using the structural integrity of the container, we've got a walkway module. So again, it's in the predetermined form that clips on to the end of the container. Then into the walkway modules, we have a prefabricated staircase module that again is actually in the footprint of a 20-foot container, so that you can just put the staircase in. If you're going, say, 2 stories, you need 2 staircase modules. If you're going 4 stories, you need 4. It's really around developing this as a kit of parts in the construction methodology. It's running the whole way through. When we're looking to put a bathroom into a unit, say, that's using, you know, non-structural walls. Most of the design is in the mechanical and the electrical engineering and where everything sits and falls. But there is a degree of flexibility in terms of where the dividing wall sits, how big you'd like the bedroom to be, how big the bathroom is, in the context of the fact that you've got a fixed brick in terms of size. It's not as simple as plug and play in terms of the building regulations and compliance, but they come with fully fitted kitchens, all of your plumbing, all of your electrics, fully designed in the unit, and then when they get craned into place on site, there is linked to the stairs and the walkways and the kit. There is access hatches, there are soil and vent pipes that run externally. It all gets hardwired in. So it's all been thought about in the design process.
One of the big advantages of this is that they're quick to put up. It's probably about 20% quicker to put in a containerized modular home. It's cheaper. And as long as it's a temporary solution, it allows us to use land that would otherwise just be left empty and idle and not being used. So some of the places that we've used were antisocial behaviour hotspots, broken down garages, and we're able to transform that. Now, they're what we call meanwhile sites, so we wouldn't look to do this beyond 10 years. But we'll be able to use some sites that are only available for a period of time, and then they're going to be used for something else. But the great thing about the containers is when you've finished with a site, you can pick them up and take them somewhere else.
So the unit that we're sat in here, this actually forms part of one of the final blocks that's going to be installed at Ealing. So this is sat in our car park for probably around another 3 weeks. The flatbed truck, so standard transport infrastructure will arrive. We pick these units up, the truck will run up to Ealing, arrive, and then there'll be a crane on site which will crane it in. The project at Hope Gardens is interesting from a land use perspective. The parcel of land itself forms part of a a significantly wider regeneration area called the Acton Estate. Post 2024, so in about 6.5 years, 7 years' time, this will be part of some public space. Those plans are obviously underway, but if you like, they're operating, say, in a clockwise manner around the estate in terms of the regeneration. So if we weren't looking to provide this project, this site would sit fallow and probably would have, I'm sure it would have some use, but it would be perhaps a lower value use to the council than providing temporary accommodation. The big things for us is about providing solutions now and using land today rather than waiting for tomorrow. The situation with the housing market at the moment, the housing crisis, and it really is, I mean, it's awful, because you've just got this disparity with everyone who's renting, and then the people that have afforded to buy, houses are just getting more and more expensive. You've got to bring housing, the cost of housing, back in line with earnings. That's going to take 20 years. You know, I don't think any of the politicians are being honest about how long this is really going to take to unravel it, because 60% of Britain owns a home. So the worst thing to do would be to crash the market. The project that we're delivering in Ealing, this is providing fit for purpose supply at end of the market, where, you know, prices are just ridiculous and the quality is awful. So, you know, there is no product there. People have nowhere, there's nowhere to go. So being able to introduce this, yeah, it's so much better than than the alternative. And it's, you know, it's part of a pathway, it's part of a journey and a roadmap towards sort of, what did Theresa May call it, the renewing the British dream or something like that. I think we're making an impact in Ealing, but in relative to the whole, it's a drop in the ocean at the moment.
The pressure in London is so great that, you know, at the moment, as a council, in terms of these temporary units, we're dealing in hundreds. We probably need thousands. For more permanent housing, again, you know, as a council we're building hundreds, but we need to build thousands. You know, there's a blockage from the government in terms of not allowing councils to borrow. If they lifted the cap on the housing revenue account, we could borrow more, we could build more. Then you've got the problem of where's the land going to come from. We're looking at brownfield sites because there are plenty of brownfield sites, and especially some that are sitting, they're not being used for a period. I, along with my senior officers, have got a fund that we've set aside which we can use to buy land, which we can then sell it on to a developer on the basis that they agree to build affordable homes. We particularly want that for our key workers, so our social workers, our teachers. Even doctors can't afford to live in Ealing these days. It's getting to that point.
The planning process often gets a lot of stick about it being slow and unreactive and things like that. And I think to a certain extent it is, because that's what it's designed to do. It's designed to consider the long-term implications of buildings that are designed to be there for hundreds of years. The development of this and other sorts of solutions, tiny homes, micro apartments, pop-up offerings, meanwhile use. We're operating in a planning system that is still thinking that it's going to be there forever. So there's a journey to go on from a system point of view. You know, it is possible, it's been proved that it's possible to navigate through the existing system, but it's just difficult. In terms of the need for housing, something like 75% of people in rented accommodation have moved at least once in the last sort of 4 or 5 years. So getting these things up and being able to move these products around, while it's non-traditional, the supply and demand is much more aligned than perhaps traditional perceptions and how we think housing is or should be. In terms of where this develops and where this goes, I think there's some really interesting avenues to be explored from a product point of view, in terms of the self-build market, in terms of co-housing, as we look to diversify the type of people and organisations that actually build houses. I think there's going to be an increasing appetite for essentially a kit of parts. You know, you can have your cantilever balcony, you've obviously got your bedrooms, your kitchens, your standard, your stairs, your walkways, you know, internal, external, pitched roofs, all of the architectural elements that you're looking for. But if you could get to a range of products that are effectively on the shelf, you know, computer-aided design, BIM, so building information modelling, all of the technological developments in the way that we build buildings, you could almost just design it with animated software and pull in the different components, a bit like you do with a car. Looking at housing sort of into the future and a little bit sci-fi is that, you know, I can really see a progression in this product to where rather than moving house, you actually move your house and you detach the value of the building from the land. It's not going to be for everything, and you still want to have long-term architecture, you know, fantastic buildings that are going to last for hundreds of years and statements and things like that. But we've got an increasing population, there's increasing demand for housing, the household sizes are getting smaller. So to be able to get a concept, a product that is sort of borrowing the land or isn't necessarily fixed to it and that could move around, I think is really interesting. You know, we move construction materials around like that at the moment. We're just creating bigger bricks.
It seems to be today's status symbol. Everyone seems to want about containers, though they've been around the 50 years now. But everyone's getting used to the fact of their modular simplicity. They can be put together, they can be stacked, they can be added to, they can be stretched. It's a bit like a lump of licorice. You can cut it to what length you like, really, and you can have what you like, whether you want to build it in a prison, a hospital, housing units. The modular unit is there, and it's here to stay.
The containers are a great idea to be used for modifying. It uses up a product that can be mass-produced very quickly. It can be modified very simply. The structure of the actual container itself is where its strengths are.
Well, I think anything that can reduce the cost of housing, increase the speed with which housing is built, is going to help. Lack of housing, cost of housing are big problems in London right now. So I think this is a way forward. There's the distinction between the temporary modified containers that we're using for emergency temporary housing and a more long-term modular solution. But clearly the crisis is too big. The demand is too big. You know, as a borough, we're going to be growing by 50,000 more people in the next 15 years, and we've got to find somewhere for them to live. So, yeah, we'll look at every option.